I realized it didn't just apply to that one specific scenario. I kind of needed to get a feel for what each person's communication style might be up front, and then just kind of levy expectations before anything happened and kind of have a standard operating procedure for every project.
Welcome to the Going Long Podcast. We're back once again to continue to help to educate you so that you feel much more comfortable as well as confident investing beyond your backyard. And yes, I am your host, Billy Keels, and I am super excited to welcome you back to another amazing conversation here on the Going Long Podcast. And before we get started, just a couple things. So most importantly, really want to thank you for continuing to come back week after week after week, or twice a week after week, and joining us here on the Going Long Podcast. Thanks to you and your continued commitment to being a part of this family, the Going Long family, we continue to move up the charts. We're attracting better guests, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that you are leaving your honest rating and reviews for the podcast. We take those ratings and reviews on board. We're adapting the podcast. We're making it even better for you and attracting a phenomenal guest that are going to help you in your long distance investing journey. If you haven't had a chance to do that already, just take a couple seconds. Even if you've had just one episode and you've been thinking, I'm going to get to it, we've also made it really easy. Leave an honest review and a rating. And there's even a little video here in the show notes. Just check it out. Leave that on the Apple Podcast platform, and we'd really appreciate that. So also, the second thing is, so many of you have been asking, like, Billy, where can I go find like the previous episodes? Or I want to hear like one of the very first episodes, and I can't seem to find it anywhere else. Go to billykeels.com. Once you get there, you can go to the podcast tab and you can see every single guest. You can see the video version. You can see the audio version. You can see all of the responses from the guests. Just go to billykeels.com. And then once you get to billykeels.com, look for the podcast tab and you can find it there. And lastly, for those of you that are interested in becoming a part of our accredited investor club, what you just need to do to find out more about that is send an email to aiclub@billykeels.com. Once again, that's aiclub@billykeels.com. Just leave a little email there. Let us know you want to find out more about being a part of the Accredited Investor Club. And once again, if you don't know already, I'll just tell you really quickly. Accredited investors are someone that the IRS says has $1 million worth of net worth, which is not including your primary residence, or you've generated $200,000 in the previous 2 years and are expected to do that this year, or $300,000 if you're a household. So, and there's also one other way nowadays that you can take a test. I'm not as clear on that one, but all you need to do is Google it, find it, and that will tell you a little bit more. But if you are an accredited investor and you want to be part of our accredited investor club, just send an email to aiclub@billykeels.com. So as it relates to today's conversation, if you are someone who is interested in understanding, like, hey, listen, I am enjoying my job, and at the same time, I want to figure out how I can actually become a part of a network, because I don't come from a family that has a bunch of people in real estate or investing, you want to figure out how to do that. Like, today's guest is going to talk to you about how he's actually gone about doing that. If you want to find out what it's like to have grandparents that talk to you about thinking about your future self, like, this is something that you really want to tap into to help you on your long distance investing journey. And also too, like, there are a lot of different tools that you can use to accelerate your moment of freedom, of financial freedom, of having more control of the outcomes of your life. Like, if you're interested in understanding any of those things, today's conversation is one that you're definitely going to want to listen to. So without further ado, and just after this quick words, we're going to get into today's conversation with Josh Plave. So I know you're going to enjoy today's episode. Whether you're an active investor or a passive investor, you really like your day job and you want to continue to go into your day job every single day feeling better, knowing that you've created the right options for yourself. At the same time, you just don't have enough time to really get your head around, spend all the hours investing long distance. Well, one way or the other, over the last number of years that I have been investing long distance, I've really understood a number of the major mistakes that you should avoid if you want to get to creating the right options for yourself much faster and being able to create more income sooner. And if you want to do that, if you want to understand more about that, I've made it really, really simple. You can just go to billykeels.com/7 mistakes to avoid. You can learn all the things that the 7 major mistakes that I've seen over and over again that I want you to avoid. Once again, you can go to billykeels.com/7 mistakes to avoid. Freedom. If you want to know how jumping from Wall Street to Main Street can help to accelerate your long distance investing journey, then guess what? Today's the conversation that you're going to want to listen to until the very last word. You know why? Because today's guest not only started in like the aviation technology space, which I think is pretty cool, also had some time where he was in software, communications, and even logistics before he moved into the area that he is absolutely adding so much value today. Because today he's helping others to take their retirements from Wall Street to Main Street and be able to have more control over their lives. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome to today's conversation the founder of Walda Main, Josh Plaife. Josh, welcome to the show, man.
Hey, Billy. Thanks for having me.
Hey, this is going to be a lot of fun, man. Love your energy. Love the pre-conversation. And I am absolutely sure that the entire Going Long family is going to get so much value out of today's conversation. So, but you know, everybody gets the same five questions. You're going to get two in the beginning. You're going to get three in the end. And then in the middle, the entire Going Long family is going to get a chance to get to know you even more, Josh. So without further ado, let's jump right into today's first question and help us understand, where exactly do you live in the United States?
Okay, so I currently live in Charlotte, North Carolina. I actually just moved here. Well, next week, it's going to be 1 year. So I just moved from Denver, Colorado, where I was at for 6 years. And, you know, we were planning to have a kid. So we moved out here and it's also closer to the markets that we take a look at in my business. So it all worked out. We're near family, we're near business. So now we're here.
All right. Fantastic. And both of those two cities are very close to my heart. So cool. So a big shout out to Charlotte today. And next question, and then we'll get into your backstory, is help us start out with some positivity, because we love positivity here, Josh. So what's the most positive thing that's happened to you in the last 24 hours?
Yeah, this is an easy one for me. We've got a 6-month-old and it's our first child. And just yesterday was the day that she learned how to wave. So before, she has never waved before. And the entire day, she just spent the entire day just going, hi. She compared us saying hi. So it's crazy.
Hey, listen, by the way, everybody, if you weren't watching already, and you're only listening to us, you got to make sure that you jump over and see the video version, because the smile on Josh's face as he's waving his hand in the air like his 6-month-old daughter was amazing. So you got to see that. You got to see that. It's one of those proud daddy moments. So Josh, thanks for sharing that with us. It always feels great to start off with some positive things. And yes, enjoy every single moment of when your children are so young and so every single thing is brand new, because those moments are precious, man. They're precious. Yeah. So one of the other things, and I give myself this impossible task, and I kind of joke about it, right? Because it's impossible to tell your backstory. You've done so many different things and you are helping so many different people in so many different ways. And I try to do it justice, but in 6 to 8 seconds, it's not going to happen. So could you do us a favor, Josh? Could you tell us your own backstory in your own words? And then also one of the things I really love for you to share with the Going Long family are like, talk to us about some of the major decisions that you've made to get to this point in your journey. And then from there, you and I will see where the conversation goes, man.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great approach to it. So in terms of kind of like what's relevant to my multifamily and I guess the retirement aspect of things, I like to go back to kind of how long I've been using these types of accounts. I opened up a Roth IRA when I was 16 years old. My mother and grandfather were both CPAs, so they kind of gave me they instilled this feeling in me that I should really look out for my future self and I shouldn't just spend money on clothes or whatever was interesting to me at the time. And so just kind of started investing in what I knew. You mentioned I was a part of the aviation industry in the past. So I just kind of invested in a mutual fund that was aerospace oriented, and ultimately just kind of kept on contributing to it and went on from there. Fast forward about 10 years from then, unfortunately, my mother and my grandfather, who I had mentioned, they had both passed away. And what they ultimately were kind enough to do was to leave my sisters and I with specifically their retirement accounts. And it wasn't like a life-changing amount of money, but it was enough that I needed to make sure that I was really going to be a good steward of everything that, you know, they had really worked for and made sure that they were trying to set up for themselves if they could live, you know, further into the future. But I wanted to make sure that it was going to support myself and my future children. And I didn't really just blow it on the first thing that seemed interesting and like a get rich quick scheme. So at the time I was working in logistics, and I knew for a long time that I wanted to shift over to real estate. And so I kind of used the opportunity to really start one of those, you know, self-taught curriculums and really just dive into everything. It's what a lot of entrepreneurs and you know, real estate folks do, listened to all the podcasts, read the books, went to the meetups, did everything I possibly could, and ultimately realized that there was a central theme that kept on popping up with everybody. And, you know, everyone would say, you know, I wish one day I could syndicate. Yeah, I want to go 2 units, 4 units, 8 units, 16. Someday I'd love to syndicate. And so I kept hearing this word pop up. And so I knew, you know, originally, I think a lot of people get involved in real estate. They go, hey, well, I see it on TV. I'm going to go flip a house. Maybe they learn about wholesaling. Maybe I'll wholesale. And so I was looking into those things and eventually found multifamily. I realized that once you build a team, it's really no more difficult than executing just by yourself on a single family home. So I felt comfortable with it, understood the numbers because I have a, you know, a deep understanding of long Excel spreadsheets and big data. So yeah, I just fit my skill set and dove straight into that.
Wow, man, that's fantastic. So you were fortunate enough to have this influence, not only just being able to talk about things, but also having real life. Hey, listen, and place your capital here. This will give you these specific types of opportunities, really thinking about your future self, which is phenomenal. And then also, it sounds like you were able to mix in that corporate experience, get some of that, what I like to say is really good training insight, and then also had the wherewithal to decide, hey, look, like maybe I don't want to keep doing this forever. And you've been able to then hear these buzzwords that kept coming up over and over. I wish I could. And if I had time in syndication and syndication and syndication, and then being able to tie it in something that you started at 16 years old with what you're doing today, I think it's fantastic. Now, there are two kind of questions that come to the top of my mind, and maybe something that I didn't talk about in the beginning is that I know that you have specifically, although today you live in North Carolina and previously you were in Colorado, that the way that you work today, you actually are at least six different states that you are working in, or five or six different states, if my math is correct or our background checks are correct. So I would love for you to tell me, right? Because one of the things, and we talk about this all the time, people always think, hey, you got to live in, if you live in Charlotte, invest in Charlotte. If you live in Denver, invest in Denver. And I fundamentally don't believe that. And I know that, well, I guess you could do that, but there are also other options, and you've gone out and you've done that. And I'm just curious, like, as to why you decided to include a long distance investing, meaning investing in a place that is not in your backyard, as part of what you do to be able to add value for not just yourself, but also for others.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it's twofold. The first, the most obvious one is the three places I've lived most time in the last 15 years are Boston, Denver, and Charlotte. And it's extremely hard to find good deals in those markets. So just by necessity, I kind of needed to look outside of my backyard. But outside of that, we're talking about properties that are between $10 and $75 million. I am not about to force myself to buy one of those types of properties in the place I happen to live in, hoping that it's the right place to buy a business of that size. I'm going to be looking for the right underlying metrics, demographic shifts that are occurring, construction plans. I want to see what the incoming supply might be and what our competition looks like once we acquire. Once you can kind of figure out all those details, it's really important to dial in where you want to invest, not where you really can, because you can invest anywhere, especially if you're building a team. You can find other folks who are experts in their field or their local boots on the ground for you. It's very doable. And it gets the results you're looking for ultimately.
And so, yeah, a lot of it is ultimately, what are the results that you're looking for? You've talked about a couple of things that are really close to my heart, and I'm glad that you're talking about that and sharing that with the Going Long family. You've talked about team a number of ways, but you just said two things, and I hope the entire Going Long family heard it, is that you said you didn't want to force yourself, number one, and then you didn't want to hope. So anytime that you are building a business, you don't ever want to be forced to do something, because then that means you're probably operating from a position of weakness, not strength. And hope is never a strategy for anybody, not yourself or anybody that you would ever potentially even aggregate capital for, right? And so just, I want the Going Long family to hear the words that you're using, because they're very, very important. And you've talked about team. It's something that's really, really important to me, and the success of long distance investing. And my thesis, I believe that of the kind of the four things that you need to look for, without a doubt, it's the most critical. Once you're clear on what it is that you want to be able to do, what's the location that you can get that, how is the team being built? And then afterwards, you can buy whatever type of opportunity or property or asset that you really want to buy, as long as those things are important. I'd love to draw from your experience here, just as it relates to team and the importance of team to be able to create success. How do you go about doing that when you're looking to build a team? And then after that, I want to pivot into the other space of the self-directed stuff.
Yeah. When it comes to the multifamily space, if you were brand new, and I came into real estate without any background in real estate. My parents weren't real estate centered. I have nobody in my family who had any experience. And so when I decided to jump straight into multifamily, I didn't have any connections that I could utilize or anything. So I decided to actually join a paid mastermind group that had a built-in network within it. And what that did essentially was ensure that I was surrounded by folks who were all following and looking for the same exact thing as I was, working towards a same common goal, and we're looking for essentially the same types of assets and acquisitions. So in that, I was able to network and find the people who there are many different roles you can have within your team, and we're looking for the people within who have. They have personality trait A, they've got expertise, expertise B, whatever it is, they fill the team out and you can build it from there based on, I have different teams for certain markets and, another one for a different market. So once you do that, you're good to go.
And so when you put yourself in a position for success, right? Because, and I'm very similar to you, Josh, like I don't come from a family. Like I was never surrounded by anyone that knew anything about real estate at all. Maybe one or two business owners, but no one that had ever been involved in real estate. And there is a real gem in what you just shared with us, which it talks about, hey, listen, if you're not surrounded by someone, that doesn't mean that you can't do it. It just means you're going to have to make certain choices that maybe other people who grew up speaking about real estate at the family table, well, you got to do something differently. And so being really clear, going back to what we were talking about in the beginning, if you're clear on what it is that you want, then you go to the location where you can find it. For you, that happened to be a paid mastermind. And that is absolutely a great place for you to be surrounded by other people. At the same time, you have to be very intentional about the action that you take in order to begin to get the results that you're getting. Would you agree with that?
Oh, 100%. If you're not driven every single day and you're not dialed into exactly what you're trying to do, there's a high chance for failure.
Yeah. Definitely a high chance, a much higher chance than those who are not doing the same. Let's pivot a little bit because I want to talk about this this specific space. And it's one of the things that also help want the Going Long family to understand. The long distance investing thesis, as we put it together, you can do it a lot of different ways. You can do it actively, you can do it passively. But in order to do it successfully, not only do you need to be clear on like kind of why you want to do it, but you need to be clear on the different tools that can help you to get there. One of the tools that you like to focus on and have a great expertise is in the area of the qualified retirement plans, and then specifically in the self-directed IRA. It's something that we have talked about in the past, but we haven't talked about it in a while. But maybe give us your definition of what the self-directed IRA is and how it could be a potentially really powerful tool for someone who is looking to accelerate their long-distance investing journey.
Yeah, absolutely. Typically, most investors who are looking to use a self-directed IRA are ones who have an old retirement account. It could be an old 401k or IRA. And what they can do with that is, there's really no limitation on what you can invest on or invest in with those types of accounts. The only restrictions are what you really can't. There's small categories like collectibles, art, jewelry, cars, life insurance policies. And it's not a huge list of things you can't invest in. So really anything you see fit as a proper, a decent investment for your retirement plan is available to you. So you just need to kind of have your funds held at a custodian who allows for alternative asset classes. Most, you know, that we hold our capital at, they're going to be looking at equity markets, and they won't facilitate these types of transactions. So you ultimately would end up moving the money to a self-directed IRA custodian who can help you invest in whatever you want, whether it's passively investing in multifamily or cryptocurrency, whatever it is.
Fantastic. So there's a bunch of different things. And I appreciate you talking about kind of the who are the different players, right? Because when you have a qualified plan, then it must go to some type of custodian. Typically that custodian is focused on, as you talked about, equities, which is really, let's just kind of keep it real simple for people, like the stock market, mutual funds, stock markets, these types of things. And what it sounds to me like, and just love your confirmation, with a self-directed IRA, you're also working with a custodian. And rather than the custodian saying that you can only invest in stocks, bonds, and mutual funds, they say, hey, listen, you can invest in that stuff as well as other things like cryptocurrency, as well as things like real estate, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There are, although you mentioned that there are some things that you cannot invest in.
Yeah, correct? Absolutely.
Okay. So I've understood that correctly. Wow. Don't you just love this conversation? This is amazing. This is fantastic. And so just really quickly, I just wanted to remind you, for those of you that are looking to create more options for yourself, get there faster and do that with long distance investing, make sure that you go to billykeels.com/7mistakes to avoid so that you can avoid all those mistakes, get to your goals faster and sooner. Once again, that's billykeels.com/7mistakes to avoid. Now back to the conversation. Also, too, are there certain people that you can invest with and certain people that you can't invest with as it relates to the self-directed IRAs?
Yeah. So these are called disqualified people. And the tricky thing is you are the first disqualified person surrounding retirement plans. So like if I'm an active partner in a multifamily property, I cannot use my retirement fund to invest in my own property. Because I am, they don't want you to be able to impart any kind of benefit to your retirement plan, and they don't want your retirement plan helping you out. The example I like to use is, let's just say you're buying a single family home, and you buy it with your retirement plan. If you were to rent it to yourself, you could do one of two things. You could either rent it to yourself for $1 and you can get a huge benefit from that yourself, or you could rent it to yourself for $100,000 a year and really pump up your retirement account. So they're trying to avoid things like that. And then taking it a step further, it's really just you cannot invest and do the same thing with any kind of linear ascendants or descendants. So we're talking parents, grandparents, children, grandchildren, things of that nature.
Okay, fantastic. So it's one of these things that the retirement plan is for once you're retired. So you shouldn't be able to benefit during the time that you're working or at any time. And then also you linear, when you talk about your parents, your grandparents, your children or grandchildren, what if I wanted to invest with a cousin of mine or a brother and sister? And this is just an example, right? As obviously people, if when you decide to move this way, you want to reach out to someone who is an expert in this area, someone like Josh, but I'm just asking just for kind of conceptual knowledge.
Yeah. Cousins, aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters, they're all perfectly fine.
Okay. All right. Sounds great. Speaking of which, right? And so there's this other thing that self-directed IRAs, because of when we're talking about these things right now, there's a lot of questions about, hey, can you do this? Can you do that? But there is also something that sometimes if people are not informed, and one of the things that we want to be able to do here is inform people, hey, listen, there are certain things you can't invest with your mom or your dad, or you shouldn't be able to invest through this type of a vehicle. But also, what are some of the other things that can happen to people if they're not really informed from either a taxes perspective? Like how does that work just conceptually?
Yeah. So the main tax that'll come into play, moving your account from one custodian to another won't trigger any kind of tax. It's still all within a retirement plan. And there's no distributions going on there. The main tax that's associated with these comes when you're investing in a leveraged property. Ultimately, what happens, let's say we're buying a 100-unit property. We put a 75% down payment on the property. That's our equity. 25% is being contributed. reverse it. It's 75% leverage, 25% is the down payment. So the 25% is equity held, you know, at your pro rata share by your retirement account. Any income that's generated by that 25% down payment is totally, you know, tax-free. There's nothing going on there. On the flip side, though, the 75% leverage, that's outside retirement money. It's not tax deferred at all. And then your retirement money is benefiting from the use of those dollars. So essentially, let's say it's 75% leverage, you'll be paying taxes on 75% of the income that comes in for that year. The nice thing is, because those are not tax deferred dollars, those non-tax deferred dollars can actually make use of depreciation, operating and interest expenses, and it really helps to offset a large chunk of the tax obligation in the end.
Fantastic. And I love that you give us a very concrete example. And once again, everybody, this is an example. Josh is just imparting knowledge with us. He is helping to make you more informed. And at the same time, if you want to understand how this will affect you personally in your situation, this is where you need to make sure, as Josh was talking about earlier, your team, you need to make sure that you speak to your tax advisor so that they can tell you how these different types of scenarios were specifically affect you. Once again, what we're doing here is just making you more aware, because the more that you are aware, you can say, hey, listen, I think this makes more sense, because the way that it's sitting in my account today with the custodian that's invested in the market, I actually want more control. I want more options. So I'd rather even be subject to the UBIT tax or whatever it is, because I have more control over it and I know exactly what's going to be happening. And you've walked through all of the different depreciations. You maybe looked at some cost segregation, all these different types of things, but make sure you speak to your tax professional. And Josh, thank you very much for helping us to understand. Now, one of the other things, because I mean, here we have a lot of people that are working in the IT space, that are working in the pharma space, the medical space, a lot of medical professionals, as well as legal professionals. And so one of the things is, you may be in this company and you've been working there for, I don't know, 15 years. I guess there's still people that are working that long in certain companies. And they have they're listening to you and they're like, oh my gosh, man, this sounds really cool, because I've got this, like, I don't know, $700,000, $800,000 in my account, or maybe more than that, or maybe less than that. I don't know. But they want to gain access to that. What are some of the steps that they can take to at least find out if they have the option to access capital that is sitting in one of their accounts already?
Yeah, it's fairly easy. You know, if it's from a prior employer and it's no longer held, it's no longer under the control of that employer, essentially, you have total control. You can move it however you see fit. If you're still an employee at the company that, you know, for whatever retirement account you're currently thinking of, it needs to allow what's called an in-service rollover. And so most plans don't allow for this. Some of the better ones do. If your company has great benefits, there's a good chance that the plan administrator allows for this type of thing, but you need to contact the administrator, see if they allow for these types of things, and maybe move a portion of your assets into a self-directed fund instead of just held within the employer contribution space.
And Josh, is this something that the employer is typically going to let you know that you can do, or will you typically need to be very proactive about finding out and asking these specific questions?
Highly proactive. It is. You need to pull up, you can either ask, or you can pull up the long, long detailed fine print and find whether or not you can do it.
Yeah. The summary plan description, you go through that. And yes. It's I love the way that you so nicely placed it. But yes, if these, once again, are concepts that Josh is helping to share with you, that you are going to need to ask the question, look for the information. But at least now, Josh is helping you to understand what question to ask so that you're much more informed, which once again puts you in a much better position of strength as you are looking to find out how you can gain more control over the capital that you have worked so hard to have placed in this qualified retirement plan. So, Josh, just maybe a couple of the examples. So, this whole concept, that you talk about, which is wall to main, like, where did that come from, man?
It comes mostly from the concept. I was kind of sitting down with my dad a couple of years ago, and we were trying to essentially, you know, he was 60 at the time, and we were trying to figure out when he could retire and time out essentially when he could phase out he's an attorney. And so he's a high income earner and he's worried, you know, if he just stops working, you know, his income kind of disappears. So we were looking at how we could slowly transition him from purely active income to passive income so that when he ultimately does retire, or maybe he works reduced hours, he can maybe take 50% of the time off, continue investing, and then really move over so that he could continue earning that same income just passively and not worry about ultimately retiring. So it was the most reliable form I knew at the time. And, you know, the biggest worry, I think, essentially was when we were looking at it, it was prior to COVID, and we were taking a look at, is the market going to be there for him when he needs to pull money from his retirement account? Can we rely on the fact that we won't have just seen a correction? And it's all about control. You know, we don't want to have to hope that the capital is still there. And we want to make sure and that we can preserve the capital in the end, because it's the end of his career. He's worked very hard. We need to make sure it's still there when he needs it.
Yeah, fantastic. And being able to sit down, strategize, and then go from the strategy to actual practical application, a lot of things can happen from that. I mean, when you're a high wage earner, you imagine you're earning a large salary, and it probably seems kind of weird. Like, if you can earn the exact same stream of income, but one is taxed at a, 39.6% and the other is taxed at 15%. Well, it's kind of a no-brainer. You're actually even setting yourself up for a better position after retirement. So that's fantastic. I appreciate you sharing us a little bit of the background on where you came up with Waldemain. And so tell us maybe a little bit also too, who are the people that you are typically helping the most today? What does that person look like when they're coming to you? What are they looking to get the most help with?
Yeah, it's been, you know, I think as entrepreneurs, we all go through the process of trying to build our avatar. You know, specifically who the exact person that we expect to be talking to or helping out is. And I've actually been a bit surprised at the typical type of person that finds the most benefit from what I do, who I help, and ultimately the properties that we find. It's typically someone who has an interest or has prior investment in real estate. They weren't aware, or they are interested in it. They didn't have the cash up front. They didn't know how to really get started. And they didn't realize that they could use all of these existing retirement accounts that have kind of just been floating around. Maybe they're at multiple companies and they have accounts kind of scattered everywhere, and helping them to kind of like combine them all into one account and figure out a strategy for the total retirement concept for them. That's really been the key, the target. I'm surprised at how few people I ultimately end up connecting with who have no real estate experience at all. It's mostly people who are either interested or prior investors.
Well, and that's fantastic, man. And the fact that you are, you're helping to open people's eyes as to what are a new tool that they can actually use to gain more control over their lives. So I think that is, I think that's fantastic. And the more and more that you're out there, and hopefully this was also going to help to be able to help more and more people. So being sharing your time with us here today. So like the thing is, Josh, I want to keep talking forever and ever, but we kind of got to get into the going long final three. And the thing is, I never ask anybody the going long final three unless they tell me that they're ready. So my question to you is, are you ready?
Oh yeah.
I knew you would be, man. I mean, I could just tell. And everybody watch the video version. You can see he's ready. He's ready for this. So listen, the thing is, we started with you over on that side of the pond. So west of me here. And now I'd like for you to travel east on this side of the pond where I am here in Spain, in Europe. Help to share with us, what is your favorite European city that you've either visited or is still on your bucket list to visit?
Yeah. Let's see. So if we're talking about specific cities, not like a small town or anything, I would go with Copenhagen. I was so impressed. When I flew in, it was the first time I ever felt short. Anyone, man, woman who was over 16 years old, taller than I was. But yeah, I was just super, I'm a bit of a infrastructure nerd. And so I was very impressed with, you know, the bike lanes, the bike super highways, the Øresund Bridge that goes from Malmo over to Copenhagen. You know, just the focus they placed on kind of incorporating modern infrastructure and architecture into their historic city and the vibe of the entire place. That was very impressive.
Yeah, Copenhagen is a very, very, very nice city. So we get another vote for Copenhagen, especially in the summertime. I really like it there in the summertime. It's fantastic. So appreciate that. And then, you know, question number two, it's always one of these questions that I usually get all nervous before asking stuff because it's about sharing your knowledge with us. And it's one of these things that I recognize from having benefited from being in touch with many really successful people. Like, and one of the things that I've always noticed about successful people, and you are a very successful person, Josh, is that like really successful people get there because they become successful because they typically don't make any mistakes. They just get there all the way to their, did I just say that again? I think I said it again. I think that's by design. I do that all the time. It's an inside joke here with me and the Going Long family. But the reality is kind of a joke, but not really. People that are successful, they are just like everybody else. Actually, they are probably, well, they do things, they make a lot more mistakes than most people, a whole lot more mistakes. But the reality is that people that are very successful, they do one thing very, very differently. And I know that you do this one thing very differently as well. And I would love for you to share with the Going Long family today, not the mistakes that you've made or the mistake, if you can think of one time, but it's more, what is the lesson that you've learned from that mistake? Because the most successful people typically stop, they make the mistakes over and over and over, but they learn from the mistakes so that they don't repeat the exact same mistake moving forward. So what's the one lesson that you know that the Going Long family really needs to hear today and that you want to share with us?
Yeah. You know, when I first started in real estate, as I went to build up my multifamily operation, I knew it would take some time to actually get it into effect. And so what I ultimately did was I started with private money lending. And so I was lending out my capital to, you know, in Boston to fix and flippers who, you know, they take an old dilapidated home and split it into three different condos and then sell it on the market. So when I lent out the funds, it was a 12-month note. Ultimately, the communication just fell apart. I never really heard what was going on with the project. The only time I actually was able to kind of check in on it was when I was visiting my friends back in Boston. I would go visit. I would be able to, you know, actually talk with the operator and go check on the property itself. But I was really not hearing back from them. Fast forward, the 12-month note ended up lasting 29 months. And it ultimately was just, it was a nightmare in terms of just negotiation of what, you know, the default rate was going to be on the note. So the lesson that I ultimately learned from that and through it, and I had to kind of improve as the time went on, because I had an extra 17 months to perfect it with this guy, was just a real intent on be intentional about the communication style that you plan to enforce upfront. You know, you don't kind of leave it to chance. There are so many different communication styles that people employ. Some people are very laid back. Some people need to stay on top of things. And I think in a position, at least when I was lending out capital, it was multiple six figures that we had, you know, with this guy. Because that was at a higher risk for me, I needed to be much more intentional about what I needed to hear, when I needed to hear it, and what, if there was any repercussion, if I wasn't. So as I kind of improved that and I realized it didn't just apply to that one specific scenario, I kind of needed to get a feel for what each person's communication style might be up front and then just kind of levy expectations before anything happened and kind of have a standard operating procedure for every project.
Fantastic. So you took that, what could have been perceived as a negative situation. Now you have then taken that and it helped you in the way that you are communicating, learning what is the right style, but doing that up front rather than doing it after the fact.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, fantastic. Well, I appreciate you sharing that platinum experience with us so that we can continue to be better and do that faster. So thank you very much for that. And then I can't even believe it's already the last question, man. Josh, this goes by super fast, super, super fast. Yeah. But I always love for you to share with us, what is the way that we can increase our knowledge base? So what is the one book that you would recommend to the Going Long family?
Yeah. So especially for those who are entrepreneurial, or they have an entrepreneur in mind. And the book that spoke the most to me in the last year or two has been Blue Ocean Strategy. It was one that it focuses on not competing in the same space. You know, every toothpaste company competes for the same market space. There's nothing new about introducing a new toothpaste. You're competing for the same customers. But when you introduce a company like Cirque du Soleil, who, you know, combines both theater, drama, circus, ballet, performative arts, you're bringing together multiple audiences into one new product. You can potentially do it at a low cost as well. And as you do that, you're able to open up what's called a blue ocean. It's one that hasn't been attacked. There's not blood in the water. It's not a red ocean. It's blue ocean. It's open for you and only you because you created this space. And ultimately, it gives you more potential. And so as an entrepreneur, it really started making me think about what I could target, who I could help the most, who has been the most forgotten as an investor. So it ultimately helped me kind of target and realign what I needed to do with Walta Main and figure out who I should be helping.
Fantastic. Blue Ocean Strategy is it's definitely a favorite, and it's one that I'm sure that the Going Long family, if you haven't picked it up, definitely pick it up and get a lot of value out of that. So Josh, man, I always just get so surprised. These things go by so fast. I feel like we were just starting just a couple seconds ago and you were talking to us about the influence that you had from grandparents who were helping you to understand, to think about your future self. And even at 16 years old, already starting to invest in a Roth IRA, which I just think is absolutely phenomenal. And then from there, you did your corporate stint starting in aviation, and then through all the way through logistics and some software stuff in between. And then afterwards you realized, hey, listen, this is a new path. I want to surround myself with some new people. I want to invest in myself. I want to start learning from people that, well, I didn't grow up with people that were interested in real estate. So let me find a way to do that. And you did that through paid mentorship. And then not only were you there, but you were actively involved. And you continue to be actively involved because not only have you invested with others, but you're now you are now syndicating with others in multiple markets, which we just love, multiple locations, which is fantastic. And even have recognized how you can use very specific tools, self-directed IRAs, to help people accelerate their journeys and getting to their goals and having more options and more control over their life. And I know that, like, I'm thinking, yeah, you know what, Josh, you and I are going to stay in touch, man. We got a lot of things to talk about. And I know that so many people in the Going Long family are feeling exactly the same way. So help us understand, what is the best way to find out more about what you're doing, Josh, getting in touch with you, with your team, so that we can also have the Going Long family connect with you?
Yeah, absolutely. We really, it's not a huge iceberg, but we just touched the tip of the iceberg here. And so on my website, walltomain.com, we have the way I've structured it essentially is an education space where you can learn about both passively investing, but really doing so with your retirement accounts and understanding how you can make the best use of what you have. We specifically target properties. We talked about that tax, the what's called UBIT tax. We specifically target properties that have the lowest UBIT impact. We have a UBIT calculator that we use on every property. And so over there, you can kind of get a feel for what the impact might be on a numbers basis, understanding overall how impactful it's going to be to your returns in the end. And also on the homepage, there's a free PDF called the top 10 tips and tricks when investing in multifamily with your retirement account. So if you download that, you'll kind of understand it all.
All right. Fantastic. So Going Long family, head over to walltomain.com and you can find out more about what Josh is doing. It makes it really easy, simple in terms of being able to use what you have already been working for and have saved up in your retirement accounts and having more control over that and then being able to use it in very practical applications so that you can create more choices for your life and gain more control. So Josh, I really appreciate you investing your time with me, with the entire Going Long family. And just want to thank you very much, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
All right. Perfect. And listen, for the Going Long family, another amazing conversation. I know that you're going to take the nuggets that Josh has left with you. You're going to put them into practical application. You're going to head over to Wall to Maine, and check him out and the things that he has going on there. So I know that I'm looking forward to welcoming you back on the very next conversation. So until then, go out and make it a great day. And thank you very much.
Wow. Don't you love hearing from top-notch experts in the field? You know, when I was getting started, I really wish that I would have had access to such experts. And even more, I wish they would have given me like a really simple list of things to follow so that I could have gotten to my goals much faster and been much happier even sooner. So that's why I've created for you the 7 things that you should avoid in order to be successful in long distance investing. And you can pick that up really easily by going to billykeels.com/7things to avoid. And also, if you liked today's episode, don't forget to leave a 5-star review. I'm looking forward to seeing you on our very next episode. So go out and make it a great day.